This piece of tech is pretty impressive. This is the Elgato Facecam Pro, and it's a 4K webcam that delivers 60 FPS and also has autofocus, and the autofocus is pretty good. Now that should be enough to blow your mind, but as I always say, Elgato's extra value is in the software. So in this video, we're gonna be unboxing it, testing it, and I'm gonna give you some advice in the software to make it look even better. So let's get to it. So when you open the box, you're gonna find the quick start guide, then you'll see the camera itself, you will find the monitor mount, and then the USB cable. Now the USB cable is going to be USB-C to USB-C, so keep that in mind. Before we even start talking about the camera itself, I want to talk about the new and improved mount. That's not what they're calling it, but that's what I'm calling it, because it's so much better than the one on the normal face cam that I have here, and better than any mount that I tested for any webcam. Let me explain. You have your normal monitor mount, right? Goes on top of the monitor, like so. At the bottom here, we're actually gonna have some sort of a wing nut in order to fasten it to the universal quarter inch thread. So we have some rubber material, anti-slip material here, and we have some over there, which is also underneath the camera itself, so it's not gonna be slipping at all. Now, the wing nut makes it easier for you to basically mount it to the camera, which is great, and then you can just fold it back. But on top of that, you can also pivot this, meaning that you can easily go from a normal face cam to a top view desk cam, and then when you flip it back, your camera will be in the exact position that it was before. The extra advantage with the wing nut is that you can rotate the camera and fasten it in one position so that it doesn't move. But yeah, anyways, I love this thing. Let's talk about the camera now. The design is great. It really looks like a premium product, but people don't really realize how big this is. Let me show you that's the previous Elgato face cam. And it's really the length of it that is big. So the normal face cam is gonna be a little taller than it, but this is what the length comparison is going to be. If we compare it to the Logitech C920, for example, this is where we see how deep it goes. But up front, this is what it will look like. You can see that there are vents basically to prevent it from going too hot. At the bottom, we're gonna see the quarter inch thread as well as a reset button. And on the back, this is where you will plug your USB-C cable. All right, you're gonna see its name on this side, but not on this side. And up front, one thing to notice is that little part right here is actually where the LED indicator is going to be, which you will see in the software is actually dimmable, or you can turn it off. All right, now we know what it looks like physically. Let's plug it in and see what it looks like when we start using it. And there it is. This is what it looks like when you're using it. It is right now at 4K. And just like the previous face cam, it is one of the smoothest 60 FPS you're gonna find. But what is most impressive with this one is the color management. It seems to really, really handle color a little bit better. I tend to have harsh, bright RGB lights in the background, and it's doing a pretty good job. Now, there might be some artifacts. That's because I have the image quite saturated right now, because that's how I prefer it. But in general, it seems to handle color pretty well. It also seemed to have a wider dynamic range, but I would have to look up details for that. I talked about harsh lighting. This is what you're gonna find on the side of my face and my shoulder here. But here, look how well it actually handles the different values on the soft lighting. Here I'm mostly using an Elgato key light that is bouncing off the wall, and then I have a tiny ring light plus my normal living room lights. And you can see that you can get pretty amazing results if you're dealing with very, very soft light at the front, and then you can do whatever you want with the background lights. So as I said, in order to make it look like that, I actually went through the software and tinkered with a bunch of stuff. But don't worry, I'm going to explain all the options that you have within Camera Hub, the software. All right, first thing I'm gonna do is reset everything so that it looks exactly like it would for you when you first get the camera. And we can do that easily by just clicking reset on everything, boom. We're gonna start at the top. The first thing you want to do is actually check here for any firmware update. You can also hold control on your keyboard and click on there, and basically click update firmware. It will tell you if you're up to date or not. Right next to it, you're gonna see the save button. This is when you're done with all the settings. It's going to flash save it into the webcam itself. So if you plug it into another computer, or if you reboot your PC, everything will be saved. So technically, if you're using the same lights, you only need to do all of this once. All right, first options we have is frame, and you're gonna see that I'm actually zoomed in 130% because the webcam actually has a 90 degree angle, which is pretty wide, which is way wider than the camera that I normally use. So it would show you all of that. But since it's 4K, it doesn't matter if you zoom in because you will still preserve so much detail, right? This also gives you access to the pan and tilt features, which is you clicking on this rectangle and then dragging it to wherever you want to frame it. And if you want to bring it back, you're going to see it snaps to the middle. and tells you, hey, this is preset B. There's also C and there's also D. D is kind of high because it's imagining this is where your head would be. But let's go back to B. Next option is the focus. As you can see, when I do this with the zoom, it actually tries to focus based on where I have it. So even though it is a digital zoom, the focus will actually respond to exactly where that rectangle is, which is great. Because if I'm zooming in to show you, I don't know, my YouTube plaque, I want the YouTube plaque to be in focus. And as you can see, that's exactly what it does. But we also have the option between center weight and spot for the type of focus metering. If you shoot on a DSLR, you will be familiar with those options. So spot is going to be basically focusing on one point, and center weight is basically going to find the best interest within a bunch of points, which will probably be around my face. You can also turn off automatic focus if you don't want it to ever be focus shifting. And this is where you will unlock manual focus, so you can put it super close or super far. That way you're sure that at this distance, this is the focus point. But if I want to show something close, it will not be in focus. That being said though, you do have presets like near, very near, mid, that's going to be way behind me, and then far, which is far, far, far away. I find that in my case, 9-10 inches is basically where I'm at. But I actually like the autofocus enough, things that I never said about webcams, to actually keep it automatic. That way I can show you this product and you can see its focus so much that you have the moiré effect, and I can do this and it's back to my face. All right, picture. We have two options, contrast and saturation. It actually didn't reset those, so those are normally at 50%. There you go. Now it's going to look washed out because you're comparing it to the previous one. As you can see, I love to bump up the contrast just a little bit, and also the saturation, which I shouldn't because I have enough color as is. I just like the vibrant look, right? One tip that I use to check out the values, basically it's to bring the contrast all the way down and basically see if the darker areas are really dark and if the wider areas could be a little lighter. So that's where you would bump up the contrast. So contrast at 50%, you can see that everything is pretty gray, but there are like, there's no black values, even though we do have some white values. So this is why I would bump it up a little bit. So now it feels more graded in a way. And then I can bump it up here. That's pretty nice. I look like this is very yellow. We're gonna play with the white balance a little bit later. Now, the exposure. We have automatic exposure, which is something that I don't wanna use. As you can see, it's getting darker, and then I'm do this, it's gonna get brighter. I don't like it, it's very amateur-ish. So usually I turn it into manual, and then I pick the exposure that I want. That's because I control my own light. But once again, for the automatic exposure, there's the spot, there's the average this time, and then there's the center weight. So center, it's, you know, mostly around the center. Average, is I believe it's going to take into account the whole image, but spot is going to be brighter because I believe it's trying to expose for my face. But we are going to turn that off, okay? And now we're getting a dark image just because of the values. We're going to explain the shutter speed. Shutter speed is basically, on a normal camera, is how much time one image is going to be exposed for before the next image goes through. So it has an effect on light, but it also has an effect on motion blur. If you're shooting, this is like film school here. If you're shooting at 60 FPS, you usually want something around 120, right? This gives you a natural-ish looking motion blur. If you go lower than that, it's going to be like a little less natural. But in our case, we're using a webcam, probably gonna live stream with it. It's not a huge issue if you have a lot of motion blur. ISO is a value that you wanna keep as low as possible because it's basically the sensitivity of your lens. It can let a lot of light in, but in turn, you're gonna have a lot of noise. So your image is gonna look very grainy like that if it's too high. So poor lighting, bad. Good, bright lighting, good, because the more light you have, the lower you can keep your ISO. I try to keep it between 100 and 300 for internet purposes, but if I'm shooting something like a film, a documentary, a commercial, it has to be 100 or even less if possible. I am decently satisfied with this. I might bump it up a little bit. Yeah, this is nice. And then we have white balance. The goal of white balance is to basically portray the white colors as accurately as possible, meaning that if you have something white on the scene and it's blue, that means your white balance is off. The problem is I have RGB lights that are projecting a lot of purple and blue lights, and the camera most of the time doesn't know what is accurate color. So that means we're gonna turn off automatic white balance and make it look basically exactly like we want. We have the Kelvin measurements between super warm and super cold. But of course, you have to basically eyeball it until it matches something you like, But most importantly, something that matches your light so that the overall color is going to be as accurate as possible. This feels like my skin tone is pretty accurate. This feels like my headset is actually pretty accurate. And there you go. Those were the options to adapt the quality to your lighting. Of course, you want to invest in pretty good lighting. I might play around with them to show you some stuff, but basically one Elgato key light bouncing off the wall is my face light right now. And in the background, in order to make the room purple, I have two RGB projectors, one pointing at my room. That's why it's purple. And in blue to give me that separation basically on my shoulder, my hair, and all that stuff. And then the rest is just decoration lighting. I have multiple videos on lighting, go watch them. So now that we have our options set, I'm gonna click on save. It's gonna save it to the device, and you will see that there is an effects tab, and I cannot show much except for the orientation. You can flip the orientation of the camera right here, but you will see AI background, and one of the best things is the blur, but I do not have access to it because my graphics card is too old. This utilizes the SDK of NVIDIA video effects. So if you have a graphics card that is like 20, 30, 40 series of NVIDIA, you will be able to blur your background. You will be able to replace your background, add animated backgrounds and all of that good stuff. I just don't have it. So let's talk about the preview. First of all, top right, you're gonna see options. This is where you will see if there's updates for Camera Hub. This is where you can automatically check for updates. And of course, tell it if you want to open up at login. You will also find your snapshot location because you can directly take pictures right here. Boom. And right next to it, you can open up the picture folder. There it is. This was me when I was recording this for the first time. And this is me now. You can also add a grid. You can also turn off the grid, and you can see preview format. You can change the resolution. So if you want to see what it would look like, 720p, 30 FPS, this is what it would look like. And then 4K preview. Keep in mind, this is just for the preview. Now, once you have everything set, what you want to do is actually turn off the preview, because like many webcams, it doesn't like to have the one source playing on multiple places at once. And now here it is in OBS. As you can see, it's not like perfect yet. We're actually gonna add more stuff to make it look even better within OBS Studio itself. So what I'm gonna do is go to filters, and what I'm going to add is a sharpen filter. It's not that this webcam isn't sharp, it's actually sharp enough, but I really like having like the extra little bit of sharpness within the 60 FPS. It gives it that really HD look. So I'm gonna add that, and I just put it at 0.02 to see like how small it is. You can of course bump it up more if you want to. And then I added a color grading filter. Now this is part of the StreamFX plugins, but you could probably achieve the same thing by using color correction. In my case, I prefer color grading. I have it, so I'm gonna use it. And you can see how it's transforming the image here. This is on, this is off, this is on, this is off, this is on. And as you can see, there's more contrast. The highlights are a little lighter. And also there's a slight color shift that makes the purples a little deeper and less pinkish, right? Let me show you those options. So we're gonna click on it and go all the way down. And this is what I changed. Lightness, I bumped it up to 105%. Contrast, 105%. And then hue shift is -4 degrees. And that's pretty much it. Now the overall image is a little dark, so I'm gonna go back into the camera hub, bump up the ISO slightly until I get to this result. I am pleased with this. All right, let me turn off my background projectors to give you a sense of what it would look like on a normal room. There you go. Decided to open up my blinds right here to show you maybe if you're using sunlight, that it still holds up pretty well, still manages it pretty well. A soft face light and basically the sun in the background. This is what the image would look like. Of course, I would probably adjust the whole color grading, but at least you have a pretty clear idea. Now, last thing I want to show you is actually how easy it is to have that top view webcam. So basically this could be your normal setup, and all you have to do is basically manipulate the webcam like this. And there you go, you have your overhead setup. And since we can zoom out because of the 90 degree angle, you can really show everything on your desk. Then just put it back. All right, this was the Elgato Facecam Pro. If you would like to see me compare it to the Elgato Facecam or the Logitech C920, let me know in the comment section below, and I will make a video dedicated just to compare the three. But in my final opinion, this feels like it deserves the name Pro. Pro in it, because the difference between the normal face cam and this one, I don't want to say night and day, but it's kind of night and day. Going from 1080p to 4K, from no focus ability at all to autofocus, and of course the improved monitor mount. I think that if you're saving up to buy the face cam, you should directly go for the face cam Pro. I think you can immediately skip this one, because you can do like product reviews, you can do so much with the face cam Pro, you can do normal YouTube videos. It's not just for live streaming, whereas this one feels like it's more for streaming. But anyways, again, let me know if you want me to compare them. Depending on the response, I will be making a dedicated video. In the meantime, go follow me on Twitch, and I will see you next time. Go out there, make me proud, get a level, out. Why did I do this accent?